I think the only way that you can manage something like that is just to be really transparent on why you're making.
There's nothing by the book that you can do in those moments, because there is no book written yet about COVID-19. There may be lots of
for any company to do, but it just shows you that bold experiments can sometimes provide really big payoffs and striking results.
Welcome to The Business Of. I'm your host, Emma Lo Russo, and this leadership podcast is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School. The ability to manage through and recover from a crisis is a staple of effective leadership, but rarely does one come along that's universal enough to impact everyone. We've seen that happen this year with COVID-19, and the way we weather change and look for opportunities to learn, evolve, rebuild, and recover from it will inform generations of leaders in years to come. In this episode, we turn our attention to the tourism industry, one of the hardest hit by the global pandemic. In the space of a few short months, we've seen airlines like Virgin Australia go into voluntary administration, and others like Qantas forced to lay off record numbers of staff. This, coupled with the closure of borders, the cancellation of major events, and a continent ravaged by recent bushfires, we are really just seeing the tip of the iceberg for the many businesses that are reliant on Australian tourism. For some first-hand perspective into how the country's tourism sector is managing the crisis, I'm joined by Phillipa Harrison, Managing Director at Tourism Australia. We'll also hear from Quirin Schwaighofer, co-CEO and co-founder of Australian accommodation innovator MadeComfy, who despite disruption, uncovered growth opportunities for his business and a way to support essential workers during the early stages of the pandemic. Finally, I talked to Richard Holden, Professor of Economics at UNSW Business School. Richard shares his insights on how we, as leaders, can navigate the long and short-term challenges on the road to recovery. First up, let's hear from Phillipa Harrison.
So, Phillipa, I'm very excited to speak to you today. Welcome to The Business Of.
Thanks, Emma. Good to be here.
So, what a challenging time. Let's just set some context for the tourism industry. First, the bushfires, then COVID. How has this impacted the sector?
This is no doubt the most challenging time the Australian tourism industry has ever faced. So, as you say, we started off the year with the worst bushfire season we'd ever had. And that had a massive impact, not just on those areas that were affected by the bushfire, but the downturn in tourism that came about as part of that, because there were images of fiery hell going out around the world, and people actually thought that all of Australia was burning, and so people just stopped coming here. So we were just sort of starting to recover from that. We were doing lots of work around the perception issues. We did some research and people thought that more than 25% of Australia was burned. It was pretty bad out there, but we were seeing the shoots of recovery from that. And then global tourism just shut down virtually, you know, in a couple of weeks. And it's just a situation that, you know, none of us had planned for, but particularly, you know, the tourism industry, which is 300,000 businesses, most of those are SMEs. They just don't have continuity plans in place for a shutdown of 6 months or more. So, you know, we went from an industry that contributes more than $10 billion a month to the Australian economy to one that is in hibernation, effectively.
How does an industry pivot and manage that disruption that you've had to experience?
Well, for the vast majority of the industry, they couldn't pivot. It was really just around hibernation and conserving cash and hoping that they get through it. Tourism Australia is a marketing organisation. We are federally funded And our job is to promote Australia to the world and to promote inbound visitation. And so our job at that point was really around making sure that Australia remains top of mind, because the path to planning a holiday and then booking it, it can be months to years. And so it was important that we didn't go dark in our market. So we did make sure that we were still there, but we pulled all of our big marketing campaigns. We pulled all of our conversion-based partnership marketing, and it was really around the tone and timing of our messaging completely changed. And it was around just talking about everything there is to see and do in Australia, but making sure that people, you know that they shouldn't book now, that, you know, that we're here and ready when the time is safe to travel again. So we have done a lot of changing. And the other thing that we've done is we've focused on the domestic market now. So we haven't been in the domestic market for over 8 years, and this is where the opportunity is going forward, certainly for the foreseeable future.
You're just under a year as managing director in your new role. How does it feel, and what was it like to experience leading an organization through this incredible time?
You know what? It actually feels really purposeful. You know, while the tourism industry was focusing on business continuity issues, it was our job to, and it still is our job, by the way, to do the heavy lifting in the marketing sense and to focus on the future when most people just aren't in a position to do that. And so, you know, we are probably busier than we've ever been, ironically, because all of our borders are closed. Arrivals in April, they were 99.7% down. So I never thought, as the MD of a new organization, I would oversee the biggest fall ever in history. But there I am. And, you know, hopefully I will oversee the biggest upturn as well.
And did you find you had to change your leadership style? Like, how did that have to adapt from maybe where you started to this period?
Yeah, I mean, I think it wasn't so much changing as dialing up things that were important. And so I think for me, there were some guiding principles. And probably the first one that I made a lot of decisions around is just putting people first. So I kind of call it humanity over economy. And very early on, I saw a webinar with Tom Peters, who I was introduced to through my time at AGSM. And he's very straightforward. And he said, you know, you're going to be judged by the way you treat people through this period. It's going to define you and it's going to define your career. And I thought, the other thing I think was really important is just being quick and making decisions imperfectly but quickly. And, you know, so we did set up a crisis team. We met once or twice a day and we made lots of decisions based on what was happening right now. And I think that was important. So the cadence of my leadership changed completely. Who I talked to and how I made decisions changed pretty much overnight. And I think you have to do that. You can't, you don't have time on your side when you are managing in a crisis and you're managing so many different, levers are coming in and there's, you know, lots of pressure. Tourism Australia is an organization that has many, many stakeholders, and trying to make the right decisions for all of those stakeholders was actually quite a, quite an interesting job.
And I read an amazing stat in terms of feedback from your team or engagement rating from your team.
Yeah, well, we did a stakeholder engagement survey. We do with our staff all the time, and it came back with 96% engagement, and an NPS, is this Tourism Australia a good place to work, went up from 23 to 44. So I think people have felt like we have looked after them in this time, and we have made sure that as they work at home, they have the right tools, and just making sure that we communicate frequently and honestly. And I think people appreciate that. I think if you treat people like adults and ask them to step up and place trust in them, they step up to your expectations of them. And we've certainly seen that with the Tourism Australia team.
You talked about cadence changing and some of the, I guess, lessons through that. How do you feel your leadership has changed, and what do you want to take forward? Like, if you could share more of your thinking there.
I think it's given me It's given me the assurance I needed and the courage, because I'm very new MD. I've only been an MD for, you know, less than a year. I've run businesses and departments before, but this is the first time as an MD. And it's given me the assurance that this way that I like to lead and the way that I like to manage, which is being authentic and transparent and imperfect and all of those things, that people like that and people respond to that. And, you know, I kind of look at the Jacinta Ardern example. I love her leadership style. I think that she is just absolutely nailing it. I can't say I wish she'd run Australia because I work for the government, but I love her. And I think that she is going to define and lead a new style of leadership into the future. And it's all around being decisive, making hard decisions, but just being warm and authentic and imperfect with that as well.
Yeah, Jacinda led a lot with talking to everyone, and I think even, you know, our own government did that. How have you engaged your stakeholders, this broader tourism community, during this period?
You know, it's a really uncertain time, and we don't have the answers that people want from us. But what we have done is just over communicate. I actually don't think you can over communicate in a time like this. I think, you know, we just changed our comms with the industry. I send a personal email 3 times a week with a summary of what's gone on in the last couple of days. Those messages have been repurposed and sent out everywhere. We do a webinar every single week. And in the early days, we're on about webinar about 14 now, but in the early days, we had thousands of people signing up because people were at home. They didn't know what was going on. And they wanted some certainty and a little bit of connection.
I think that personal approach to leadership's obviously transferred then to that group. How do you keep the leadership style and then take it forward?
Previously, my role was a lot about going out and traveling and being places and, you know, and I will continue to do that. I think it is important to go and be face-to-face with people. You know, generally as people, we just like face-to-face communication, but the tourism industry is all about relationships. It's all about delivering personal experiences. So, you know, for me, it's just about keeping up that cadence in a more face-to-face way. But I think also, you know, I will continue to communicate in some of the forms that I have over the last couple of months. I will continue to do webinars and podcasts and things like that. And I think it's also, for me, it's about thought leadership. And one of the things that I have done over this period actually is set up a bit of a strategy unit think tank that I really want to provide the thinking that people are after. People are looking for thought leadership from us. What does consumer sentiment look like in the future? What is the industry, the distribution going to look like? You know, what travel agents are left? What wholesalers are left? You know, what experiences are people looking for? So one of the things that we're doing is really stepping that up, because people want that practical help and don't necessarily have the means or resources to do that themselves.
You know, I was talking to a friend in Mudgee, and she's saying how that region has really opened up because everyone's looking for their experiences, but within state. Or how do you see that flourish and the lessons learned and being taken forward for those types of businesses or regions?
As Australians, we love travelling, and over the last couple of decades, it's been all about travelling offshore. That's where the excitement is. That's where the bragability is. And 6.5 million of us took leisure trips offshore last year, and we went off and did all those experiential and amazing things, and that will come back. That's not going to change. But what we're trying to do as a government and a marketing organisation at the moment is to, and I've got a hashtag for you because we're in marketing, holiday here this year. And it's really about our opportunity is showcasing how damn amazing our own backyard is, and that people should get out and experience Australia. Because it's interesting, the top 10 domestic destinations do not correlate with the top 10 international destinations, because Australians are, you know, I'm not worried about the hotels in Noosa. They're going to fill themselves. It's the Great Barrier Reef. It doesn't even feature in the top 10. It is the number one reason people come to Australia, is to see this natural wonder of the world, and doesn't even feature in our domestic top 10. So we have a bit of a job to do to show Australians again just how amazing all these incredible experiences that we have. There's some amazing multi-day walks all over Australia that have come up and developed over the last 10 years that I don't think people necessarily know about. You know, there's Ningaloo Reef and the whale sharks. There's the Kimberley. I mean, there's all these amazing places. And we think there's a real opportunity here to get people focused again on their own backyard. And we also think there's probably going to be a little bit of nostalgia around the road trip, and people getting back in their cars and, you know, taking those 3 and 4 hour drives and discovering things along the way.
Well, I'm doing my bit for you. I would have been overseas at this time, and I've just come back from an up the coast holiday, and I've booked a down the coast holiday, and I'm exploring areas again. I've been there before, but, you know, it's different lenses, different ages. You do different things. I'm curious, what would you advise someone who's going to face a crisis to make sure that they get through it? What do you think your kind of key lessons have been, or recommendations?
Look, the key one for me has been around communication. It's really hard to underestimate how important it is to communicate. I mean, we've even seen that through this crisis. You know, the daily updates from our leaders have been, you know, they've been a point of certainty. They haven't had a lot to say, but there has been the point of certainty where we're going to hear from somebody who knows what's going on. They're going to tell us, you know, as much as they know. And so I think that regular and clear and transparent communication, I probably would place at the top of the list. And then the other thing that we did early on was to set some sort of framework for making decisions. Because as I said, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of stakeholders. There's a lot of things going on. And so we early on set a framework around consumer sentiment, because we are a marketing organization. And so we sort of decided that we were going to monitor our markets, and it's domestic, but it's also, you know, many other markets around the world that were in different stages of crises. And so our reaction has to be different at those. We looked at 4 different kind of mindsets, and one was panic. When people are in panic mode, they're trying to work out what they're doing. They don't know, do they have a job? Is it safe? What do we do? Where's my toilet paper? We're trying to work all that stuff out. You know, that is one mindset. When they get locked down and there's restricted movement, they start dreaming a little bit and thinking about life beyond. Then there's the rising optimism of things are starting to open up. I can maybe go to Mudgee for the weekend and all of that sort of stuff. And then there is when there's unrestricted free movement, this new environment we're in, what are people going to want then? And so we sort of have this green light project that has looks at a number of kind of, I guess, data points, if you'd like, and we decide where a market is, and that determines how we act and how we market and what we do. And that has really helped us frame with the industry, with our stakeholders, with our teams, the sort of the decision-making that we needed to make. So that was really, really important as well. And the other thing would just be the crisis management. Make sure you move quickly. Make sure you meet frequently. Make sure you have a cadence that is quick and you're able to be quite nimble.
So you talked about observing or measuring consumer sentiment. And that you said that was both domestically and that was also internationally. Like, what techniques do you use? What have you observed over that period? And what do you think is likely to stick by way of that sentiment?
Yeah, so there's a lot of research on consumer sentiment at the moment. Some of that is going to be sticky, and some of it is just of a moment and, you know, really a reaction to the way people are feeling right now. But we do know that there will be this connection with family and friends is going to stay around for a while. It's really important. Sustainability and traveling with a light footprint is something that has gained a lot of interest and a lot of momentum over the last decade. And towards the end of 2019, it was something that a lot of people were talking about. It is going to be more important now. I think this crisis has amplified that. So traveling in a sustainable way visiting sustainable businesses is going to be important to people. So we think that that's going to really dial up. You know, so we are sort of changing and looking at how we manage that going forward as well. And I spoke to an operator who has an 88-year-old mother-in-law in Italy, and she was saying that after the Second World War, people were different for a decade. They changed what was important to them. Their priorities were more around family and friends than things, and they really had a sense of appreciation for the earth and for the land around them and for the great food that they were given, because they were denied that for so long. And I really do think that those things are increasingly important for people. And so that's certainly a messages that we are going to pull into our marketing and also into our product development going forward.
So the path to recovery, taking, you know, that view of what you can and can't control, how are you looking at building this recovery period, and over what period of time are you currently modelling?
I think it's going to take a few years for the tourism industry to recover. It was the first affected. It's going to be one of the last to recover, because leisure tourism is, you know, it's something that's not going to come back in the same form for quite a few years, we don't think. So what we're looking at in terms of recovery is just, you know, where the fish are at the moment. And we also think that cohorts from offshore are going to come back in a slightly staggered manner as well. So students might come back first, business leaders might come back first, and then potentially people visiting their friends and relatives before those bigger, really high-yielding travellers come back. So we are just making sure that we are making the most of each of those markets as they come online, if you'd like to use an imperfect word, and looking at all the levers that we need for that. So aviation recovery is a really important part of that. You know, more than half of the airlines, the world's aircraft are parked at the moment. All airlines are going to come back as smaller airlines, and our job as an island is to make sure that as many of those as possible are pointed towards Australia. So we're looking at aviation recovery, and then just, you know, making sure that Australia is top of mind, and that, you know, what is important to people right now, we are offering up. And we're in a great spot with that. You know, safety and security is the number one rational factor that people have when they're deciding on where to travel. We are a very safe destination, always have been.
What about you as a leader and your leadership team? What do you think is going to be the way forward for you leading now that you've gone through this crisis? What stays moving forward?
It's a big question. I think I'm happy with the way that we are at the moment. I think we need to, as I said, keep some of the lessons that we learned through this period. But I think you can't always run an organization like you're in a crisis. And I think, you know, for me, it's working out the right time to get back to a new normal. So one of the things that we are looking at is what is our structure in the future? And that's not something that we can determine right at the moment. We've made a few tweaks and changes, but the structure of the future is going to depend on the tourism industry of the future, who our customers are, what distribution looks like, what the industry looks like. And one of the things that I'm going to focus on is, are we fit for purpose? And I think there's going to be quite a lot of soul searching around that one.
Amazing. Phillipa, I have enjoyed so much talking to you. I feel like there's so much to learn.
It's lovely talking to you. We'll do the next one over a glass of wine. How's that?
Sounds perfect. I'd love to.
This is The Business Of, a podcast looking at what it means to do well and do good in the world of business.
Wow, I don't think many businesses would face a 99.7% downturn that Phillipa had to. But it was her choice to go to humanity over economy, the speed in which she changed the cadence of her leadership team, the emphasis she placed on communication, and genuinely changing with great speed to help those customers in the way that they needed. We can all take something from that. The business co-founded by my next guest is a true Aussie success story. Since its launch in 2016, MadeComfy has transformed into a fast-growing and multi-award-winning disruptor in the accommodation sector, and in 2019 became an official partner of Airbnb. Let's go to my conversation with Quirin and hear how he's led the MadeComfy team through the challenges of COVID-19.
So Quirin, welcome to the business of. I've loved watching MadeComfy grow, but can you give a brief overview of how it's performed and grown since you launched it?
Thanks, Emma. A pleasure to be here. So thank you so much. We are a short-term rental brand. We provide quirky and comfortable, safe-contained accommodation at a high level of consistency and cleanliness, service, and quality to travelers that stay between sort of 3 nights and 6 months and prefer us to hotels or random Airbnbs. We're about 4.5 years old as a startup. I think we're still a startup. And been growing in Australia since, with that vision to be Australia's most loved short-term rental brand. And it's been a very exciting time since we started. We grew a lot year on year. And and then this year sort of have the pleasure to face a few things with the bushfires and COVID-19. So lots of things to learn and to grow on.
Before we kind of probe those challenges, because I would agree, what a challenging and unpredictable year that, being hit with both things. But what inspired you to start the company?
Well, there are a few things. If I summarize it to three things, one thing was when I did my MBA, I was a sales engineer at a sort of mining company. And I remember I did managerial skills with you. And it was really impressive how you did your own business. You had your family and it seemed like you could do anything. And I was like, wow, what am I doing actually? I'm like in this corporate ladder. I thought I'm doing like everything I can. And that was like a really eye opener. And I met a few other really incredible founders at that time. The second one was really, I got to the point where I really need to be challenged and I need to be excited about things. And I really lost that in my corporate career and really, I thought I need to do something else. And the last thing was then the third thing, I stayed in an Airbnb in Melbourne at a Formula One race and everything was booked out and a friend recommended Airbnb. I was like, okay, I've not stayed in one in 2014. And when I got there, I was like, how smart is she? Like I used to live back then in Cremorne Point with amazing views. And I thought I have a Formula One every morning and evening with the sunrise and sunset. And why am I not renting out my place when I'm traveling? So went back, put my place on Airbnb, and I thought that was very easy. I got bookings, but that's when it started to get difficult to really manage the whole process. And Sabrina, my co-founder, helped me a little bit, and that was not sustainable. And we did a bit of research to find someone to help, and suddenly this whole thing opened up where we realized there's a whole ecosystem growing, especially overseas in the US and in Europe. And Australia was around 2-3 years behind that, but we could really see this all happening. And we thought like, wow, no one is in that space. And naive as we were back then, we thought let's do that and build a hospitality business based on that.
Well, I should say thank you for that reason one. I didn't ask that question to get that answer, but I thank you for sharing that. I mean, I think you're right. I know I learnt more than I ever imagined going from corporate to doing my own startup. You said that naivety. I mean, what do you think the first lessons were at those early stages?
Why I'm really saying naivety is because if you knew everything, and I'm honest to myself, I'm not sure if I had the guts to actually do that. If someone gave me this book and said, okay, you have to tick that all, and if you don't, you will fail. And even if you do tick it, there's a high chance that you don't make it, but good luck. And really, I don't know, like it was this whole naivety of starting a business. It's so easy. You click a button and you register a company and like, you think like, oh, that's so easy. And we were lucky that we built a website on Website Builder. We got a booking, a customer the first really week, and we thought that's so easy. And But then really building a business is so much more than that. Learning about how to raise capital, for example, we knew very early we had to raise capital because it is quite tech and service heavy piece. And I'm not a developer, Sabrina's not a developer. So we knew we needed to build infrastructure. So learning about how to really raise capital, I had to Google what a VC is and really learning how to do a pitch deck, how to really do that. Whilst doing that, really how to build a company from all the things you don't talk about, your HR, your legals, marketing, inbound marketing, like all these things where in the corporate world, it was done by someone and you had little insights. Learning all of that is like a whole study itself, and naivety drives you to make more mistakes and to be really challenging with your goals. And I think that sort of gets you forward. The second thing next to naivety, I think, is what you need is persistence, because you fail a lot and you get told a lot that what you do will not work or it's a bit of a nonsense. The more you hear that, usually the better it is, because less people try it. And you might really end up in a place where you add something really valuable to others, which then is what it's all about, adding value to others that are willing to pay something for it.
So you're going through all that massive learning 4 years in, you've got 50% of your customers from overseas and you get hit by fires and then COVID-19.
Yeah.
What was that impact like? What did that mean for your business?
Well, it was a shock for everyone. At first, we thought, okay, worst case, what can happen? Things just, we have to close MadeComfy. We're not going to get through this. We thought about what do we do with the team? Where do we find them jobs? What are we doing? How do we pay our things? And that was about a week. That was really, really hard. We really realized for MadeComfy, the bottleneck was properties. Getting more properties meant you get more guests, and the whole travel market was growing itself. What we realized is for the next couple of years, properties will not be the bottleneck, because the long-term market will be impacted. A lot of other shorter rentals will simply not be booked. So let's pause all marketing and sales in that space. And how can we fill the properties? Because if we fill our properties, we will get more properties. So that was a really key change in shifting. And we went back to the wall with our post-it notes and started with our strategy diamond, with our all these kind of frameworks you sort of get thrown at when you do your MBA. And that really helped at that point. And yeah, we came up with a strategy from after a month where we knew we'd get out of that. Now, whilst we did that, we also had, of course, to save the business. So we knew we had to cut around 60% of our OPEX because we will not be able to get the revenue back that quickly. And one key advice I got from Rolf Hansen, one of our advisory board members and a mentor of myself, was always make sure you have control. If you have control, you can do things. If you lose control, that's when it gets ugly. And so to keep control, we had to reduce our cost to manage our cash flow and runway. And that was a very difficult point, because you can only cut costs in so many areas. And it was a point where we had to be very true to our values, especially trust, agility, and empowerment. And sort of it was very clear for us that making people redundant and just letting them go was the last thing we want to do.
So do you want to share a little bit about those steps, the strategy change, that pivot that you undertook?
An amazing thing that really came out of that was our CTO, Tom, came up with this idea. We used to do cross-functional teams before, sort of more sort of casually, but he said, look, we have to change so many things, and it's so difficult to align tech with marketing, with sales, with customer experience. So we are... one focus for us is the corporate market, where we think companies that do have to travel to make a revenue will have to travel. And hotels is maybe not the nicest thing to put your staff into, especially where you have other people that are getting quarantined. And what we have as an HR is spacious, self-contained properties at a lower cost as well. So there is a really interesting part. So how can we get companies to book a MadeComfy? And so to do that is so complex. And so Tom came up with this idea about these mini pods. We call them mini pods now, or MadeComfy pods, where we have maximum 16 members, one captain, And we tackle mini project by mini project by mini project in a really 6-week quick huddle where we have someone from marketing, sales, tech in there. And it's, for example, the target is to get the very first corporate booking. What's that MVP we have to get there? One other one is we, in the whole time, the last 3 months, we launched our own booking page. So what can we do to increase conversion by 20%? And we now have 3 of those pods, and it is now no longer Sabrina myself to really lead that. We are out. We watch. We're not allowed to get too much involved, but it's incredible to now see that it was the best thing we ever did to not let people go, to now empower them to help us to be aligned with our strategy, our OKRs, and our goal to evolve MadeComfy in like these mini robots, mini bots, like to mold MadeComfy into the shape it has to be. And I'm super excited about that. And when I look at the faces of the team, from this kind of anxiety they had a month ago to where they are today, empowered and really excited, is just, there's nothing better than that, than watching that.
So would have, again, been such a great learning from a leadership perspective. So looking at your leadership style through this crisis, and love the idea of those mini pots, what do you feel your biggest lessons are?
Well, I think there's nothing by the book that you can do in those moments, because there is no book written yet about COVID-19. There will be lots of case studies, I'm sure. But it's about a few things. I think being true to your values is so important, and showing empathy and being persistent, I think, is a few important things, and to have a clear vision. And that is something you learn, you experience, you really don't read in a book. And I think it shapes you as a leader for the next challenge that you will face. But it is an important part. The second one, really, to trust your team and be a more of a supportive leader. So you go from the front to the back, is again something that requires you to be able to do that. So you have to put your ego back. You need to really know that others can do better as a team than you. And all these things you learn about and read about, great, but it's very difficult when you know everything is at stake and you have to trust that what you put in place works. Again, is so easy read and so difficult done.
If you were writing a book or you were contributing to a book, what do you think this crisis has taught you about leadership or resilience? What are you going to take forward no matter what?
That's a good question. I think never be too confident that you're there. That's it. I think we were on this amazing traction and close to our Series B, and then something hits you. In this case, it's just nice. It hits really everyone. What the maybe main learning there is like it is so daunting, and like from a stress level point of view, it is very difficult. And the one thing that really, like, maybe I learned from it, would really put in the book, is don't worry about things you can't change and accept those things. Understand what is the worst case scenario and be really okay with that, because you simply can't change. There is no unfair, there is no things, it is simply life. And then really focus on the things that you can change and that you can tackle. And there can be so many things that you maybe haven't done before. We've done personally so many things, tidied up certain areas financially. Sabrina and I got married, which we wanted to do for a long time. We just said, okay, let's do this now. That was when there were only 2 people allowed, and then we had a wedding with 20 people. It was amazing. But all these little things, also within the company, like these mini pods, that would have not really happened without this crisis. And when you look back, when I look back to myself, when I learned the most was when it was really difficult, tough, unfair, and sort of you make it or not. This is when you learn a lot. So when a crisis like this happens, see that bit. This is one of those moments you will look back and you will say, like, hey, wow, I grew so much in this time. And I learned so much from that, that I am a different person, a better person. And whilst you do all of that, just make sure that whenever you look in the mirror, that you can look into the mirror and that you do not regret whatever you do.
Quirin, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you, Emma. Thank you very much for inviting me.
This podcast is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School.
I really enjoyed speaking to Quirin again and seeing how far he's taken his business. It was good to reflect how you don't really know what it's like to start a business, and your speed of learning is exactly the same speed you need to learn and pivot in a crisis situation. But I loved how he set up those mini pods for his team to fast track problem solving and drive innovative thinking during this crisis. Perspective is such an important part of leading through a crisis. And my final guest for today lends us plenty of it on both the human and economic challenges that lie ahead. Let's hear my conversation with Richard Holden, Professor of Economics at the UNSW Business School.
Hi, Richard. Welcome to The Business Of. I'm really looking forward to speaking to you. And starting with, what do you see as the biggest short-term and long-term challenges we face on the road to recovery?
Well, I think in the short term, the biggest challenge is getting the public health crisis under control. The long-term crisis is going to be getting our economy back moving again. We're going to be trying to get unemployment down from levels that we haven't seen in decades. We're going to be coming out of the first recession in about 30 years. And we've got a situation where the Reserve Bank's interest rates, monetary policy, is really no use anymore. They can't, practically speaking, go any lower. And so it's going to be up to government using its policy levers to try and get us back on the sort of economic track coming out of COVID.
So what do you think are the different skills or perspectives that drive each of those stages? Because they're quite distinct, aren't they, in quite different areas?
That's one of the things that I think has been interesting about the crisis, which is we've seen a lot of deference to public health officials and so-called medical experts. And I think that's been really encouraging to see. There's been some people lamenting how we don't trust experts anymore. And I think in this instance, our medical experts have really acquitted themselves incredibly well. The National Cabinet and the Prime Minister in particular have put a lot of faith in them. They've done a great job. So that skill set is still obviously very relevant while we continue to weather the health crisis. And unless and until we have a widely deployed vaccine, rather, you know, more or less worldwide, then those skills are still going to be very, very important. But we're now going to need to see skills really on the economic repair side of things. And that's what's coming into play now. And that's going to involve everything from thinking through fiscal policy and how to deploy government spending in a useful and intelligent way, to thinking about policy reforms in areas that are going to range from industrial relations to tax policy to education policy, really across the economy.
There's also the fact that we've done more online. You don't have to travel overseas, or you can employ someone overseas much more easily. Does that change the opportunities or the thinking about what future organisations or the economy can recover to leverage?
I think it's a really interesting opportunity in two ways. So the first is, you know, as we know, Australia's pretty far on a plane from kind of anywhere and very far from certain places. And as someone who spends a reasonable amount of most years in the United States and a little bit in Europe, I know that all too well. And so this is going to mean that remote work can be done more. Time zones and things like that still really matter, but that still gives us big opportunities within the region, thinking about some of the Asian countries that are on similar time zones to the east coast of Australia. I think the other thing that's a huge opportunity with technology is to try and think about remote work within Australia. So we've had a kind of forced experiment, if you will, with a whole lot of people in jobs that can, you know, to all intents and purposes, be done from home. So people who do their work on a computer can be on a Zoom call, things like that. That's obviously not everybody by any means, but those who can have, you know, sort of by necessity taken advantage of that. And some companies have, you know, seemingly been surprised by how successful that's been. So we've seen overseas companies like Twitter saying, you know, we kind of thought, and Facebook saying, we kind of thought there'd be a drop in productivity. Looks like it's gone up. And they're already making work from anywhere options permanent going forward for anyone who wants to do it, even post-COVID. And so I think we wouldn't have seen that kind of experiment. It would have been a kind of brave thing for any company to do, but it just shows you that bold experiments can sometimes provide really big payoffs and striking results.
I mean, that's a great example of the positive side, but what in your view are some of the common mistakes leaders make when they respond to a crisis?
I think that the most common mistake that leaders make is not realizing there is a crisis. I think the real mistake that lurks for Australia now is not understanding what this kind of recession is. And I think the right way to think about it is this is a recession in two acts or in two parts. And part one is the supply shock. It's COVID. No one wants to buy anything. Everyone wants to stay at home. The government then comes in and helps coordinate that lockdown and changes it from a sort of self-lockdown into a mandated lockdown. There's really good work coming out of the US by Stephen Levitt of Freakonomics fame and Chad Severson from the University of Chicago, showing that about 90% of the contraction in economic activity came from the self-lockdown, people just not wanting to go to the shops and get sick, not wanting to spend money that they might not have in a crisis, anticipating getting laid off and so on. And then you have the government come in and there's the self-lockdown. That contracts the economy because there's a whole lot of stuff that normally would get produced or supplied that doesn't. Now, once the health crisis is dealt with and things open back up, and we're then going to be left with high unemployment, damaged business and household balance sheets, people with back rent, people with back mortgage payments, landlords who may or may not get that back rent, who've got their own back mortgage payments, people without the income that they thought that they would have going forward, but a lot of other financial obligations, and a real damage of confidence both on the consumer and business side. And so faced with that, we're going to have what looks like a much more ordinary but very significant recession. So think of the early 90s recession or maybe even the financial crisis of 2008. So I think the big risk, the big watch out for us is to think that once you've dealt with, as a government, the supply shock, or if, as I like to put it, COVID recession phase one, to then ignore that there's going to be COVID recession phase two. And you need to do in that instance all the things that governments normally do on the policy side in responding to a big, ugly demand side recession. I think the concern is the government is going to take their foot off the kind of fiscal pedal and think things are going back to normal. And my own view and the view of most mainstream economists is without continued fiscal measures of a pretty significant size, that recovery won't happen as planned.
Where do you see the traits we saw in the government leadership to business leaders in how they can approach their recovery?
So I think, you know, good leaders tend to, explain where they're going. That's important for the people that are in their organisation, whether that be, you know, a business or a, you know, a university or even, you know, the military or something. I think people in an organisation understanding what the strategy is and where you're heading is really important, but also all the other stakeholders that are involved. So I think business leaders who are able to say what it's going to mean for their customers, what it's going to mean for their suppliers, what it's going to mean for all the other people that are touched by their operations, you know, shareholders obviously as well as a very important stakeholder. I think being clear with people is really important.
What do you think are the short-term sacrifices we've made? How will that lead to the long-term recovery?
Yeah, I mean, I thought very much and said early on that the pain we were suffering on the economic side was best thought of as an investment in the economy of the future, that we were taking pain in the short term. And for some people, it was extremely painful. For other people, you know, it wasn't so bad. There was a real distribution of pain and loss during that time, and that continues to the time that we're speaking. But I think of that as an investment in the economy of the future, and so that was a smart thing to do. Similarly, I think organizations coming out of this are going to have to think about how they adapt to, if not a permanently new world, a changed world for several years. So international travel is not going to be coming back in a meaningful way anytime soon. We don't know how long that's going to go on for. International trade has taken a real hit and there are increased tensions around that. There's a lot of pushback around globalization, which I think has been one of the huge drivers of the world economy. And Australia as a country that gets roughly a quarter of its GDP from exporting and importing, you know, is potentially going to be hit really hard by that. So again, thinking about what sacrifices we need to make to get us through this period for the longer term, I think is really important. And there
What do you think are the most important things Australian businesses need to get right to rebuild post-crisis?
I think one of the things is trying to use the crisis in the moment for whatever restructuring and reform they need to do. So again, I don't really like to point to silver linings about things as devastating on both the health and economic side of this, but to the extent that there might be a positive that comes out of it is that incremental change is often not the way to get to where one needs to go if significant changes need to be made. And so this may be a moment for businesses to really think about large structural changes, and those things are the whole reason they don't happen easily with incremental changes because they're often really hard. So will retail chains sort of incrementally close down one store at a time? You know, during normal times, yes, they might do that, but this might prompt them to really rethink their entire footprint and their business model. You know, and the same with, you know, whether it be universities, whether it be airlines like Qantas, whether it be our supermarkets and thinking about automation, thinking about home delivery. We've seen big changes with that, again, completely necessitated by the crisis. But these are changes that could be made in a really significant way. So I think sort of using the crisis for those sorts of changes is an important thing to do.
So I hope you don't mind me asking this question, but I'd love to ask you if you had the keys to stimulating our economy or maybe some of those transformations or innovations that could be put in place to ensure our economic recovery, what would they be?
I've got a long list, so I'll try and keep the greatest hits.
Good.
I've been saying for a long time that we've got an internationally uncompetitive company tax rate. Been some measures taken on that, but really only for smaller businesses. That's good, but I think it's insufficient. So we've gone from having the second or third lowest tax rate in the OECD to having the second or third highest tax rate in the OECD. And that's not because we've been jacking it up. It's because other countries have been lowering it and making it more competitive. And so we stand at a real disadvantage to companies like Singapore and the United States, France, the United Kingdom, and others. And so I think that's one area where, you know, more work needs to be done. I think that the education and training system, particularly in the post-secondary area, needs to be really thought about carefully. You know, one thing that's often talked about is TAFE and making sure that provides skills for people who aren't going to have a university education but are entering a workforce where, you know, more than just manual skills are really required and are really at a premium. That's incredibly important. And I think understanding that our university sector is now in a global market. We're in a global market for students, both coming into the country and our high school students, you know, our sons and daughters leaving the country potentially, maybe not during COVID, but, you know, that will happen again. And also we're in a global market for researchers and faculty members that are educators and researchers. And that's something that's, you know, been a secular trend over the last few decades. And so understanding that we need to think much more carefully about the structure of the funding and the nature of the incentives and responding to market-based pricing signals in the education sector, particularly the tertiary education sector, I think is incredibly important. And thirdly, I'd say industrial relations reform, something that people always talk about. There's a process going on now, which is good to see. We'll see what comes of it. It's the government playing more of a role as a coordinator rather than a facilitator, rather than driving a particular agenda, it would seem. We'll see if that works. I think it's admirable that it's being tried. But we have a situation where there are good things about our industrial relations system, and it's very good that we don't have a situation, as is the case in the US, where people can work full-time really hard and be below the poverty line. That's a social disgrace and also an economic disaster as well. We don't have that situation in Australia with our industrial relations system, but we have a whole lot of other rigidities in there that frankly make it harder for business to hire people. And hiring people is going to be at more and more of a premium now if we want to get unemployment down and be internationally competitive. So I think there's going to have to be stuff done on both sides. And something that I think transcends or sits over the top of all of this is doing something meaningful with climate change. And I think that, you know, the technology roadmap that the government's put forward and Labor is now making supportive noises about is fine as far as it goes. As I and many others have said before, if you don't have market-based pricing signals, essentially some kind of price on carbon, then technologies aren't going to get developed in the right way and they're not going to get adopted in the right way. So technology is an important piece of the puzzle, but without price signals to drive the implementation of that, it's not going to happen, and that's going to leave us in a really bad situation, both in terms of the environment and in terms of the competitiveness of our economy.
Richard, you've done an amazing job at taking what's complex levers, I guess, to make them accessible and easy to understand. We can't, they say you get what you vote for, but if you don't hear it articulated so well, then people might not know what to champion. Thank you for your time today on The Business Of.
It was lovely to chat. Thank you.
The Business Of is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School. For many businesses, there's no denying 2020 will be remembered as one of the toughest years on record. But I observed an optimistic confidence through my conversations with today's guests that we will indeed recover. While communication, quick thinking, and action are paramount in crisis recovery, one thing that really stood out to me is that reflection is also an important part of the mix. As Richard said, good leaders tend to explain where they're going. Knowing that and being able to identify and communicate what it means for customers, suppliers, and stakeholders is the recipe for success. Thanks for listening to The Business Of, brought to you by the AGSM. If you've enjoyed this episode of the podcast and want to hear more, search for The Business Of on your favourite podcast app and subscribe.